Would you bow with me in prayer, please?
Father God, thank you so much for this great encouragement to worship together. And Lord, as we continue to worship you now, as we come to your holy word, we ask that you will truly help us, Lord, that our hearts can be totally open to you and our mind unplugged with any biases from what you want to tell us and teach us, and open our eyes to see. And Lord, truly we ask you for the grace and mercy and your favor that we can do what you teach us and tell us to do in your holy word. We pray this in Jesus' name and for Jesus' sake, amen. Regarding the Guatemala experience, we've had that partnership with them now for some 15 years as an association with this group there in Guatemala. And actually this year, each one that's elected to go on one of the teams, whether it be the adult, VBS, medical, construction, or with the youth, we're also looking at sending a grandparents team in December. Each one received $500 assistance through our association to make that trip. The missions team of the association is meeting tomorrow night to decide what we're going to try to do for 17, if we can extend that another year for those that would like to go to Guatemala. But the simplicity of life there is so great an education to all of us as Americans. We don't need all the junk and stuff, sorry. I love good things. But if you look at my car I drive, it's been partly through the Guatemala experience. People look at my car, I don't have to lock it up. Nobody even touches my car, it's so old. Police look at me and say, maybe that car can get up to speed limit. We don't think so, I don't have to bother that guy. He's not gonna go fast. But all that to say, in Guatemala, life is so simple. And when they do come to know Christ, they don't have all the filters bothering their being able to see clearly that Jesus Christ is the pearl of great price. They grab hold of that easier and quicker and better than we do as Americans. I'll come back to that maybe in the message in a little bit, but the fact of it's a great experience, and if you can possibly go sometime in the future, please do. If we do have the grandparents team, we'll announce that this week after the meeting tomorrow night. That's for anybody of grandparenting age. But Carlos, that Rob talked about, is so sensitive and careful in taking care of us older dudes trying to do something down there on the grandparents team. He's really good to us, but they want to use us during the month of December to go in and just love on kids. And that opens up more doors then to go into the homes of those kids and reach them for Christ and then start new churches. Rob mentioned about going into public schools. The Guatemalan government constitution is so heavily influenced by the Roman Catholic Church, it's so predominant, has been there in its history, that there's no separation of church and state. So the group that we work with there, the Baptist churches in Guatemala, they right now have some 25,000 public school children every week in Bible study that they conduct, and that they've used the teams like Rob and them going down, painting school buildings, whatever, that earns credibility with the principals and superintendents. They say, hey, come on in with your Bible studies. So that's what's going on with this partnership. And it's really helping us a lot in seeing what God can do with us here if we can learn similar faith and heart for God and for people and one another. Take your Bibles and turn to Acts chapter 2. I'm going to try to have a little bit of a shorter message in light of all the wonderful testimonies we've already heard. But we want to turn to that great missionary book of Scripture. And I thought about that. I need to catch myself. All the books are great missionary books in the Bible. I mean, you've got Jonah told to go to Nineveh, that wicked city of 120,000, and tell them God loves them. And you got Abraham in Genesis. God gives him a covenant that through you, all the nations of the world will be blessed by you teaching them about there is a God, like our young people said at Jeunesse, that loves them. So all the scriptures are great missionary text to all of us. The gospels are giving us Jesus' heartbeat. I am come to seek and to save that which is lost. The epistles are teaching us how to do church so that we can be used of God to fulfill His life mission for us as churches and as individual Christians to make disciples. So I want us to just read back, visit again. What was going on as soon as Jesus goes back into heaven with those early believers? And it's recorded for us here, particularly in Acts chapter 2, the closing seven verses of that chapter. Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. Let me read that. They devoted themselves, they committed themselves to these four things, all right? If you'd like to stand in reverence to the Word of God, do so, but carefully listen to what the Word of God says to us that He was doing and blessing this church to do, that He wants to bless us to do. They committed themselves to these four things: the apostles' teachings, that's the Word of God, to the fellowship, that was the agape feast. They shared meals a lot as Christians, and just catching up with one another, like Rob said, what's your highs and lows? We do that better over food than through Skype or Facebook or whatever. And then three, to the breaking of bread. They practice the Lord's Supper regularly, reminding themselves, why are we here? We are here because we are bought by a price, and we have a Savior and a Lord that has a mission for us to fulfill. And we've got to keep our eyes on Him and do it together. So they shared that common reminder, taking the Lord's Supper, reestablishing graphically, what are we still here for? And then fourthly, to prayer. Thank you. Prayer wasn't some just scheduled thing in their lives they did once a week. Prayer was their lifeline. Now, I'm not going to preach a message on prayer. You've heard lots of messages. But can I just ask you, how much time do you spend each day in prayer? Am I blowing us up, Kenny? Or we good? All right. I'll put it there and maybe that'll help. All right. But how much do you and I pray? I mean, how are we clear in our understanding that if I don't pray, nothing's going to happen today? That's eternally good, and that's going to really bless my family. And that's going to put me in a position where God could even use dirt like me and a wicked man like me to help others find out about Him, and that they can have Him in their lives. So if that's true, how much time should I be spending in prayer each day? Now, that's going to be different for all of us. One of my mentors, in fact, I hope to release a book on him in the next year or two, is Charles Spurgeon, who is reputed to be the greatest preacher since the Apostle Paul in most seminaries and Bible colleges. But he said, I can't spend more than 30 minutes a day in prayer on my knees if my life depended upon it. But he spent the whole day in communion with God. People would be walking, taking walks sometimes when they have a chance to visit him when he wasn't working. And they would just stop right in the middle of the walk and start praying over something. That was the way he practiced every day. All I'm saying is that for the early church, they committed themselves to prayer because they understood we have not because we ask not. And Jesus had taught them in just his last 3 years of his life before he goes back into heaven, ask and you'll receive, seek and you'll find, knock and it will be open to you. And they really believed that was the case. That God would do that if they sought him, asked him, and knocked on his door. Verse 43, everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. Now, I can't tell you everything about what that verse means. I know there was a lot of healings. There was a lot of miraculous things. We don't see that as much today. I know because I don't have the faith I need to have. God is still the same God as He was then as He is now. He's still the same God. But I do know this. The greatest miracle is when a heart gets changed from being self-centered, selfish, and sinful to being others-minded, forgiving, and a heart for God. That is the greatest miracle in life. Hospitals can fix bodies. Schools can try to help fix brains and minds, but only God can fix the heart. Verse 44, all the believers were together and had everything in common. I watched again last night. For all of you, Voice of Martyrs sells this DVD set, 9 or 10 DVDs, on these great Christian heroes of the past. Many of them lost their lives as martyrs for the faith of Christ. But if you can get a hold of that, those are such great bios of these great Christian heroes. And they're made in children's story form, and then you can go behind it for the documentary, and that's about an hour interview of primary research of people that knew these people personally talking about their lives. I like to watch these with my grandsons. I like to get them exposed to these great Christian heroes. So last night I just turned off myself to watch about Jim Elliot again and those four other friends from Wheaton College in 1952 that were killed by the Inca Indians in Ecuador. I mean, they were just in their prime. They were just young 20-somethings that loved God so much. But they were committed. They had already said it publicly. If we lose our lives, may it be for the glory of God and for the furtherance of the gospel. They were tight in their unity and in their teamship because they had all things in common in Christ. They knew what their life purpose was. If you know that story, just in the next few months, their wives of these martyred saints there in Ecuador came back to those Inca Indians that killed their husbands and invested their lives and transformed that whole tribe into missionaries for Christ. It's a tremendous story. Verse 45, selling all their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Now, this wasn't socialism. As you study in chapter 4, it gives us more enlightenment upon what they were doing. But back at that time, some were losing their jobs because they were Christians. And they were very practically loving one another and just sharing excess and whatever they could to meet one another's needs in their circumstance of dire help needed. 46, every day they continued to meet together in temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Now, if there is a key verse in this passage, that's it, okay? I'm going to come back to that in just a second and close out the message. What's our mission as a church family? What's our mission individually as followers of Jesus Christ? And if you do not have a relationship yet with Jesus Christ for yourself, that can happen before we leave here this morning. Praise God. Today is the day of salvation. Behold, now is the accepted time. But if you do accept Him into your life, what are you here for? What is this church here for? Now, they understood that they were coming together for mutual encouragement, and then they kept doing it all through the week in their homes, meeting together and also inviting their non-Christian neighbors and friends and others also into their lives to check them out and to check out their Savior. Rob has mentioned about music and how people choose churches. We call it the first 4 minute principle in church growth. The first 4 minutes, people are going to check out a church and make their decision the first 4 minutes they're coming back or not, before they ever hear the music, actually. Because it's those greeters, it's those people that welcome them, it's those people that seek them out in the parking lot when they're coming in, it's those people outside the buildings and how they're smiling to them or taking notice of them or welcoming them. They start making their decision about what kind of a place this is, what kind of people these people are in this church. And they, you know, may greet me. Sorry, I'm looking here. They may greet me at the front door, but do they invite me into their lives after Sunday? You see, that's where the rubber meets the road about us practicing our Christian faith. Are we truly loving one another? Do we really have things in common? Do we really understand what our life mission is? And are we truly growing in that love and sharing that love with others in practical and meaningful ways? When that is happening in a life of a local church family, then 47, verse 47 becomes real and true. Let's read it. Praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who are being saved. Wouldn't that be neat if First Southern Baptist Waterford was seeing one person a day come to Christ and being added to the church? Well, Jerusalem was a little bigger, so Waterford's not quite as big as Jerusalem was at the time, about 60,000, so maybe they were a little bit ahead of the game as far as the ratios. But if we saw one every other day come to Christ, I'll take 167 a year, 182 a year growth in a church, being added to the fellowship, being discipled, being sent back out for Christ. Now, in your outline, I appreciate the guys getting this out. Would you just look at this real quickly with me, and we'll just talk about this in a practical way as far as theological framework. Where are we getting this from in Scripture? What is it meaning to us as far as applying it to our lives as a church and as individual followers of Jesus? What does it mean? There's a statement there that says we need to be relational in order to be missional. Let me just comment real quickly. We need to be learning to love one another like Jesus loved us, so that when I go to work Monday, when I go to Walmart Tuesday night, when I interact with different people in my weekly schedule, I've got something cooking in my heart and my brain that I know this Christian life is real, because I'm experiencing acceptance and love and prayer and encouragement from my Christian brothers and sisters. And when I have this opportunity to share something with somebody that I meet at Walmart or wherever it is, or a person at work that I've been praying for, I know it's real stuff because it's working in my heart. I'm seeing it in my Christian family. We need to be relational in order to be missional. Keep that in mind. Jesus gives us the great commandment, a new commandment, and the great commission. The great commandment was what? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your fellow man as yourself. Then he gives us a new commandment in John 13, 34, and 35. I can't quote it exactly, but you know the verse. I'm giving you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. By these attitudes, by this kind of living out your Christian faith, all the world will know that you are my disciples, because you have love for one another. I had a friend 30 years ago shared about while he was pastoring in Los Angeles. They'd done a study. Then he went on to become one of our professors at Golden Gate Seminary. But he said, we have studied people coming into our church, and we've asked them, what drew you into our church? They said, well, the message of Jesus was truly inspiring, but when we saw the church body loving one another, we knew it was true. And that sealed the deal for us to make our commitment to Jesus Christ with our lives and join into the family. And then he gives us the Great Commission. And so it's kind of like, here it comes in a sequence, in those orders. All three of them are binding, right? All of Word of God's binding on us. Great commandment, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your fellow man as yourself. A new commandment I'm giving you, love one another. This is how the world's going to know that this Christianity stuff is real. And then I'm telling you, go into all the world and make disciples. And now if we understand that right, he's telling us, make disciple making disciples. Because he phrases it, teaching them all the things that I've commanded you. So what did he teach them? Go, like the Father sent me, I am sending you. I am come to seek and to save that which is lost. Now, we can't do the saving, but we've got the information and the goods on who can do the saving. We can share with people, our friends, our family, people we work with and live with in our neighborhood. Jesus Christ can give you a personal relationship with God the Father, and you can be made accepted into His family, and you never have to be alone again in your life. So wherever we go, we can know, my God is with me. I don't have to be discouraged. I don't have to be afraid. I can believe and choose. God is with me. Not because I have great faith, because I have a great God. Now, those next four words on your outline, our Lifeway Ministry in Nashville, what we used to call the Sunday School Board, and Tom Rainer is still serving as president. He's getting ready to retire, I think, from Lifeway. But Tom he used to teach at Southern, taught evangelism. He's done a lot of different research about the Great Commission work through our churches and through our individual lives as Christians. He wrote a book one time on different kinds of people, including Satanists, Buddhists, Muslims, that came to faith in Christ. He found four things was common in all their testimonies that influenced them and cause them to give their hearts to Jesus. It's these four things right here. Acceptance. Non-judgmental behavior. Active love. And real listening. Now, we don't have time to unpack all four of those, but I'd encourage you to just give it some thought. Do people feel accepted around me? Do people feel like there is no judging going on when I talk with them, interact with them, approach them? Some people teach and say you can smell an attitude a mile away. Do they feel like I'm a person who's for them? Active loving. Doing things that practically demonstrate you really are concerned for them. We saw this in 1991. We moved from Texas to Las Banas to pastor. We eventually got moved onto a cul-de-sac because we had little small children, and Carol wanted that safety situation that way. Over the next 2 years, we would bake brownies, take them to our neighbors. I'd mow the neighbors' yards when they were sick or out of town. Just doing things. And God, those simple acts of love opened more doors. And eventually, three of those families of our neighbors came into the church, came to Christ and came into the church. Just, we must love them before we can lead them. John chapter 10 teaches. That's the way God got you, amen? And so we're the hands and feet and heart of Jesus to people around us. These are His ways. These are His attitudes. These are His practices. The more in you and I grow in these practices and these attitudes and these activities, the more we position our lives to be able to influence our non-Christian friends at work, in our neighborhood, wherever, at school, to come to our Jesus and to be used by Him. Those five bullet points below there, 2 hours below Guatemala City is a church. I've been studying this church for about 15 years. It's in San Salvador. I'm hoping on one of these trips someday that Carlos can take me down there. See this my own self. They are a church that actually began at Guatemala City, landed eventually years later in San Salvador, but they're a church that runs approximately 150,000, 175,000 in church. Everyone in their church has these five bullet points memorized by heart. Remember we said verse 46 was probably maybe the key verse in this passage we're looking at? They met together corporately, but they also met together in their homes, actively sharing God's love non-judgmentally with their neighbors, active loving them, and listening to them. This church has 2 meetings a week in small groups, they call them. I'm not sure the official name of their small group title is, but one meeting's on Tuesday nights, that's for Christians. It's to build the Christians up in the Word of God, be there for one another, be there in each other's lives, pushing each other forward to follow Jesus. When we come to Sunday school, when we go to a Bible study group at a home, it's not for us to learn more about the Bible. It's for us to get more of the Bible in our lives and help one another do it. Interpretation without application is abortion. Is that right? Interpretation without application to my life of Scripture is aborting it. Those who hear my words and don't do them, they're building their lives on sand. But interpretation with application is transformation. Those who hear my words and do them, they're building their homes on solid rock. And whatever life throws at them, they're going to make it. Because they know whose they are and who they are standing upon. Every week they meet for Christians to be edified. Then they meet again at the end of the week. And they've planned that before they get out of their first week meeting. This last part of the week's meeting is going to be for their non-Christian friends. They're going to bring them in, have a good time with them, love on them, listen to them, and they're going to share Christ with them. Man, they've just been doing that for years. Here's the five things. Every Christian has a purpose. True? I mean, that's why the number one highest selling book in American history outside the Bible is a Christian book. It's called Purpose Driven Life. Because God made us for a purpose. That's why people are reading that thing so much. Everybody's wanting to find their purpose in life. The purpose of every Christian is to win the lost to Christ, to make disciples. That's what Jesus told us, right, in the Great Commission. I want you, as you are going, that's the way that word go is translated, as you are going through your daily life, God loves this world so much, every day God is orchestrating opportunities for you and I to say a word about Jesus to someone. Do you believe that? It blows me away. But doesn't God say He knows how many hairs are on your head? If that is true, don't you think God can orchestrate an opportunity every day if we'll ask Him? That purpose is best fulfilled in groups where there is accountability and encouragement. They were meeting in their homes, in groups. We're going through a thing right now with our pastors. Pastor Dennis is in it. We call them cluster groups. We're studying that we have for too long divorced the teachings of Jesus from the practices of Jesus, the principles of Jesus from the methods of Jesus. Jesus had 12 for a reason. And somehow we're needing to learn anew the opportunity and the ways of building, working together as churches to make small groups that make other small groups that make disciples. Multiply groups that multiply disciples. That's what they were doing in Acts chapter 2, verse 46. That's what they're doing down in San Salvador. I've been on this study journey for 30 years. I started studying in 1985 about the church over in Seoul, Korea that had 300,000. They eventually got right up to 1 million. Every week meeting in cells. Studying a church in Singapore, a Baptist church. It's in excess of 100,000. They meet in cells that multiply disciples. Studying a church in Bogota, Colombia, in excess of 500,000. They multiply groups that multiply disciples. The Christian will never be satisfied if he does not fulfill his life purpose. Is that true? I can put my ladder against a lot of buildings and climb with all my heart, but if I'm putting it against the wrong building, I ain't going to get there, what I'm going after with my life. I will never be satisfied until my life fulfills the mission that God gave me. Psalm 37:4 is a wonderful verse. We talked about it at Jeunesse. Delight yourself in the Lord and He will give you what? The desires of your heart. What does it mean to delight? It means put your commitment, your focus on all your values in. Again, this is why it's... We actually had all of our missions professors come to Atlanta when I was working back there and ask them for their input in 2005. Could we in America see God do what He's doing in Bogota, Singapore, Seoul, San Salvador? Could it happen here? The guy said, it's possible, but not probable. We've got so much stuff and baggage as Christians in America that distracts us from really being delighting alone in God. I can get a new car. I can get a fatter salary. I can get this title. And we get so otherwise minded on other things that it depletes our focus on Jesus and our understanding. Whatever else may go on in life, He is my pearl of great price. We have no promise of tomorrow. If the purpose of the Christian is not be fulfilled now, it may never be. How much time do you have left with your life? When it finishes, what do you want to look back on? And when you graduate to heaven, what do you want your family to remember about you and your values and your focus and what was really important? Now we close with this. Jesus says in Mark 8:35, the person who loses his life for me and the gospel, that's the person that's going to save their life. He says to us in Mark 3:14, he appointed those guys, those 12, to be with him, number one. Be with him, that number two, he could send them. It's a great study in scriptures, to study the word sending. You got Isaiah chapter 6, he has this great worship experience. How does it finish? How does he finish that worship experience? Oh God, send me. The passage of scripture, this Charles Spurgeon I mentioned earlier, he said this passage of scripture weighed more on his heart than any other part of the scriptures. It was that passage, Matthew 9:38, the harvest is plentiful. Workers, that's what we need, workers. Spurgeon said this wasn't some preacher talking, some seminary professor talking, it was the Son of God talking. Every day you and I walk out, there are hearts that are hungry because God's drawing them. And he is showing them that what they're going after is going to bring them to the end of their rope. And he is the only salvation. And then Matthew 4:19. Jesus says, decide. I am the one to give your life to. Number two, develop in me. Follow me and I will make you. Number three, I want you to deploy with me every day you go. The greatest way you and I as Christians will know that God is with us is when we are with Him on His mission. Robin and I experienced this last week. 4 weeks ago, the adult team of 15, every morning we're praying, every night praying together. Why? We just knew we had to have God's power. The Jim Elliott story, those five guys that lost their lives, they were excited, even if it meant that, because they were sold out to Jesus. Can we stand with our heads bowed and eyes closed, please? Everyone standing, each head bowed, each eye closed. I want to invite you as we close this service, if you're here in this discussion and talk about such a Savior and such a love, that you could be able to forgive anyone the hurt that's happened to you because of having Jesus, the forgiver of all sins, in your life. If you don't know that, we want to give you that opportunity. In just a moment, I'll pray. We'll have some music. We'll give you the opportunity to make that response. Just come and I'll pray with you and we'll settle that together with the Lord, that you'll walk out of here knowing God is with me. He is with me. Secondly, if you've been a Christian for some time and there's not just been a real understanding and awareness of your life purpose and knowing God's presence and His power in a meaningful way in your life, you may just want to come or right where you're standing and say, God, please, these five bullet points of these Christians in San Salvador, would you make them real in my life? I want to be on mission with you. I don't want to just cruise through life not knowing God's with me. I want to be used. I want to be sent. If there's anything else, maybe you're here and you're just wanting to plant your life in a church family. You've been looking for one. Let me just say there is no perfect church, okay? It's made up of us sinful people. But this is a good church family that really does love the Lord and love people. And you'll find a good place to grow in your faith and be sent by your God, being a part of this church family. If that's your need and desire, then you come sharing that as well. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for just being so awesome, so good, so faithful, so consistent, so right on. Oh God, thank you that we know about what you're like because we see what you are like through your Son. Everything we read about Him, what we've learned about Him, what we will yet learn more about Him reflects everything You are. And so, God, we pray that You'll help us to know that we are with You and that You are with us. Help us, Lord, to even in this closing time to assess and evaluate our lives and to make plans and make commitments that allow us to know that better. We pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen.